and not here in the Olympic Stadium. All finals this evening. We've got the women's high jump. We've got the men's javelin in the field. We've got the men's 5,000 metres final, the women's 800 metre final, the women's 4x4 relay, and then the session ends with the men's 4x100 metre relay, which will feature the powerful Jamaican squad attempting to retain their Olympic title. Well, the javelin throwers leaving the call room now, and that gives me an opportunity to get the first words of the session from John Traer.
Hi, good evening, Stuart. Peter, what a great night we got ahead of us this evening in England, London time, or England time. Men's javelin throw is going to be particularly interesting. Just been talking to Mr. Backley over there with some Finnish journalists. Three Finns, pretty standard, usual. They look a bit messy, but one of them is going to get there somewhere and be top eight. But then, we've got the world junior champion from Trinidad and Tobago. That's fantastic, isn't it? And a Kenyan who's 21 that threw a personal best in qualifying. We've got the Southern Hemisphere represented with Farquharson from New Zealand. And we've got a Japanese thrower. So we really are sort of crossing the globe in the javelin event. And then, of course, the high jump is fantastic. It's got such great opportunities for somebody to come out the pack, or the old stage Alibut, who won gold in Beijing, to come back after she's had two children in the last three or so years, to come back and deal with what might be a difficult wind. It'd be a difficult wind, I think, for the javelin boys, and I think it could be a difficult wind for the high jumpers. So experience, composure under pressure, all the things that happen at the Olympic Games that I think are just sort of not doubled, but certainly increased tonight by the circumstances of what we got within the arena.
Well, we certainly had a lot of tremendous competitions throughout. Almost every event has given us plenty of thrills and spills, and a very, very high standard. And you're quite right, those two field events in particular are very well worth looking for. On the track, we'll have the men's 5,000 metres, and of course we've got a hugely enthusiastic crowd to spur on Mo Farah for a potential double. He's up against the might of East Africa, and of course such an experienced practitioner as Bernard Lagat of the USA, easily the oldest in the field, some 20 years older than, for instance, Gebre Hiwot of Ethiopia. But we start the evening's proceedings with a couple of victory ceremonies, two or three in fact. We usually have some for the events that have been determined on the previous evening. We're going to have a couple of relays this evening as well, which we'll be keenly looking forward to, the men's 4x1 and the women's 4x4. But here we have the presentation for the men's 4x400 meters relay, which was determined last night. Well, we've been accustomed to see the USA win the 4x4s, but it wasn't to be this time. Suffering, of course, from injuries to three of their top runners. So they had a couple of reserves in the team, a couple at least of reserves in the team. They still got the silver medal. Medals presented by Mr. Pierre-Olivier Beckers from Belgium, member of the IOC, and the flowers presented by Robert Hirsch, Senior Vice President of the IAF from the USA. If you can hear a bit of a roaring noise, which we can, there's quite a wind blowing here in the stadium tonight. John Traer will give you his usual wind report later. So the bronze medals in the 4x400-meter relay is Trinidad and Tobago. Very fine run. They just held off the local team from Great Britain, who anchored by Martin Rooney, just couldn't quite make up the deficit, and it was the Trinidadians who prevailed. Team of Lalonde Gordon, Jaron Solomon, Adi Alain Fort and Dion Lendor. So now we come to the silver medals. And they go to the United States of America, who had a team of Bryson Nellum, Josh Mance, Tony McQuay, and Angelo Taylor. McQuay ran a very fast leg indeed. And Taylor, though, at the end, hardly blame him, but he wasn't able to withstand the challenge posed by Dion Lindor. But an inexperienced US team without Jeremy Warriner, who has a hamstring injury, without LeSean Merritt, who was injured and barely got into the heat, and without Manteo Mitchell, who broke a leg in the heat and yet still delivered the baton on the first leg such that the US could qualify. Champions, their first gold medal. The Bahamas team of Chris Brown, Demetrius Pinder, Michael Mathieu, and Ramon Miller. Ramon Miller particularly running a brilliant leg on the last leg, and of course, perhaps even better, Demetrius Pinder on the second leg. But it's a very fine all-round team, this. Mathieu, the third runner, was disqualified for a false start in the 200 metres semi-final, but he'll be more than happy to take home a gold medal.
Well, we have the 5,000 metres race coming up in about 38 minutes' time. There's Koech of Kenya, one of a very, very strong field, as one would expect. He's only 18, 12:48 this season, and world youth champion a couple of seasons ago, and how many of the youths of the Olympic Games have performed so well. Gebre Meskel may well be a real threat in this race, the world bronze medalist last year at 5,000 metres. He may well threaten, and of course Mo Farah of Great Britain will be going for the double. He has the 10,000 metre gold medal already and will look to the double. And we shall see whether he can achieve that. It would be an absolutely magnificent double. A man who really has gained in belief over the last few seasons, let's put it that way. There's Gebrewet as well. Gebrewet, second fastest junior of all time. He's only an 18-year-old as well. I mean, there's so much youth in this field. And we saw what happened in the 800 metres, a young man, Amos from Burundi, doing 141.7, astonishing. The youth has emerged, certainly in these Olympic Games. And I expect it to happen again in the 5,000 metres, which is the first event on the track. We've got some very good field action for you before that, with the final of the women's high jump and the men's javelin. You can see them warming up very closely to us here in the commentary position. And well, John Tra, the men's javelin, let's see who we've got to look for in that. I think we can go and have a look in the training area for them.
Well, they're out in the field
now.
They're here, aren't they? Yeah. It starts at 19:20 local time, so Peter Markey is picked out by the people that are in these positions to highlight some of the competitors. You know, he struggled for two throws in the qualifying, but then put one together for his third. He qualified on his third attempt. There's a bit of strapping being applied there. That's probably Torkinson. Oh, no, it's not. Yes, it is. He usually straps up that left ankle. He's got a fairly poor strength in that foot from various clunking over the years throwing-wise. Stuart Farquharson from New Zealand. You know, he's well ranked this year, over 86 metres, but hasn't really proved it at this level. Not yet. It could be his night. And then we have Vitislav Vesely, coached by Jan Zalesny. And what a story that would make, Zalesny winning three gold medals and a silver in Seoul. And coaching this young Czech, well, not young, he's 29 now, but coaching this Czech athlete. Also coached Spodakova in the coaches Spodakova in the women's, so that'd be a double for a coach, wouldn't it? We also have the women's high jump taking place at the other end of the stadium, the 100 meter start end, and you'll see there that the Olympic record was set in 2004 by Slezarenko, 2.06 meters. It could be tricky conditions for the high jumpers tonight. I think it's going to be tricky for the javelin as well. The wind is quite strong and it's swirling in this stadium, and the 12 athletes who will be introduced to the crowd in a little while are listed now in your screen. And in there at number 12 is Tia Hellebo of Belgium, who is the, yeah, she's got a sister jumping as well. Just for Stuart, that one. She's the reigning Olympic champion from Beijing. Had two children since 2008, sort of come back to athletics each time she's recovered from the birth. And to her credit, she's arrived here with a season's best of 197, I believe. So the girls are lining up. And we'll be pretty soon, we'll be going through that list and just giving you a little bit of information about all of them. But there are 12 in this final tonight. And what a treat in store there is for the spectators, not only down the D end where the high jump is taking place, but also around the stadium, because the pictures that get transferred around. So we have Skoglina of Russia, 2 meters one this year. Trigaro Green of Sweden, she's jumped 192 in 2012, 2005 world bronze medalist. Gordieva of Russia, the 25-year-old who's got a PB of 202 but has jumped 199 in 2012. Svetlana Radzivil of Uzbekistan, 196 in 2012 and a personal best of 198. Berku Ayhan of Turkey, 22-year-old. She's the Turkish record holder and has cleared 193 in 2012. And then we have from Russia, Anna Shikharova, 30-year-old, who's cleared 2 meters and 3 centimeters. She's the world champion from 2011, having won silvers in 2007 and 9, and Olympic bronze in 2008. Shantae Lowe from the United States of America, the 28-year-old, US record holder, and the 2012 world indoor champion. Ruth Beita of Spain, the new European champion in 2012, at her fourth attempt. 2 meters she's cleared this year. And from Lithuania, we have Arina Palsytė of Lithuania, the 20-year-old who's cleared 195, has a personal best of 196 that she jumped in 2011. Melfort of France, 195 in 2012. Brigitte Barrett of United States of America, World Student Games champion in 2011. The 21-year-old has cleared 201 in 2012. And then number 12 to jump is Tia Hellebo, the defending Olympic champion. She's cleared 197 this year, but she has a personal best of 205 set in that final in Beijing.
Well, our other track final is the women's 800 meters. That looks like a fascinating lineup, with Kasta Semenya showing the sort of form in a semi-final, which he hasn't done all season, and running a very fast time indeed to get through to this final. So the world champion of 2009 looks to be back in the same sort of shape. Maria Savinova has been the top runner in the world for the last couple of years, and won the world title, of course. Pamela Jelima was a tremendous champion in 2008. She also shared the Golden League jackpot last year when she was unbeaten, emerged from almost nowhere. Hasn't done much since, but she's obviously back in very good form now, so she's bidding to retain the title. That's going to be a fascinating race due off later today.
And in the high jump, we've got the second jumper to come into the competition. Emma Green Tregago from Sweden has the first failure to her name. She takes that honor. Just got too close and couldn't get a high point, couldn't get that arch around the bar. So she gets across the first attempt at 1 meter 89. So this is Olga Gordieva, and she pops clear. Easy clearance for the Russian. Nice run around the curve. Good control at takeoff, and that transition from horizontal to vertical, very tidy indeed. Now we have Radzivil of Uzbekistan, 189, first attempt. And she goes clear too. We can expect, certainly at 189, quite a few rapid clearances as the girls progress. And Berku of Turkey, her first attempt. Her first attempt at 189. Oh, she lost the run-up as she came around on the curve.
and has gone back now. She'll, oh, knee strapping came, look at that. So as she came running in, her knee strapping came off. Now she'll be restricted not only by that, but the fact that she has a minute to complete her job. Right, she's still got plenty of time. 28 seconds to go on the clock there. She should be fine, but it does make you rush just a little bit, doesn't it? Let's see if she can compose herself. Nope. Well, that very often happens. Just got put off by something as simple as not putting your knee bandage on correctly, or the Velcro's not connecting as well as it should do. And as a consequence, she has a failure at that opening height of 189. Now, the bar's going to progress in 4 centimetre chunks to start off with. It go 193, then 197, and then come down to 3 to go to 2 metres. 203, then 2 to 205. So this is Chikarova of Russia. Great clearance for her, first attempt. She goes clear, gets a nice round circle on that attempt, comfortably over for the Russian. Shontelo from USA lines up and ready for her first attempt at this opening height of 1m89. Wow, there you go, that's how you do it. I sometimes think in the high jump, you know, these early heights, there's a bit of energy sort of overused, if you like. But they've got to make sure they go clear, so you can't really hold back pressure the situation, but she's jumping it as if she's cleared 2m10 there, I'd say. Baita of Spain. The newly crowned European Championship. Won it on the fourth jump in the jump off. And she does. We've talked about this week in the high jump, haven't we, Stuart, about but keeping the jumping side shoulder high. Well, she actually does that by leaning away to keep it up. So she tilts herself. She probably does it more than any other of the high jumpers, but it's a definite tactic and technical move to just keep the right shoulder in position.
Yeah, and also that inside knee is driven high as well to create the platform off which the rest will come. So. But just watch once again the contrast in the type of approaches. This is a technique, but there are lots of styles within it. They come wide, they go straight, they turn quickly, they turn slowly. There are lots of different ways.
Yeah, Palsiti of Lithuania. And she goes clear. And of course, the crowd have only this high jump in going on at the moment, the stadium, so they're all paying great attention to the girls taking their early attempts at the opening height. So Palsite from Lithuania goes clear at this opening height. And next to jump will be Melanie Malfort of France. And this will be her first attempt at 1m89, the opening height in the women's high jump. Well, didn't look as smooth on the run-up. It's a little shorter and she was a bit toey, but she got the business end right. And good at takeoff. Nice curl over that bar, that arch. Easily just clearing the bar and comfortably over the opening height of 189. It's interesting, but it looks like all of the girls are coming in and starting at this height, this opening height of 189. This is Brigitte Barrett of the USA. Yep, she goes clear. It's a bit infectious down there, these clear jumps. These first attempts are all going over. They've all caught the bug and a couple of early failures, but they'll come back up and I'm sure 189 will be cleared by all these girls. I'll probably give them somebody who failed on the first attempt a bit of a kiss of death there, but they all look fairly accomplished at this height. And the last girl to jump in this round, before we go back to those that knocked it down on their first attempt, is Hallebo of Belgium, the reigning Olympic champion. And she'll be pleased with that. Got the whole crowd clapping for that one. So they appreciate the fact that she's the reigning champion from Beijing.
Considerable athlete, of course, a former world indoor pentathlon champion.
So second attempt for Gren Trigaro from Sweden. She had that failure on her first attempt, so she'll be concentrating on going clear to join the 10 others currently that have gone over this opening height. Just one other girl, the Turk, Ayhan, has knocked it down. So. And the sweep goes clear. So that'll settle her nerves a little bit. First jump was a little nervy, sort of was a bit jointed, but this disjointed, but this one much more connected, and good transfer from that run-up as she arched round to the takeoff point and then just raised, kept her right shoulder up. Good contact at takeoff, high knee, and over she went. Now, this is the Turkish athlete, Burcu Ayhan. Second attempt, 1:89. Oh, and now she will be under a bit of pressure. Out of all the field and the competitors, coach wants to have a word. He's beckoned her.
Well, of all the competitors, her best of 1:94 is the least of any of the field. There are 8 2-meter jumpers in this field, very high quality. So she's done very well to make the final.
I think she has. And just looking at her personal best in 2012, it's just 1 centimetre low, according to what I've heard. So 1:93 this year. So we're only 4 centimetres off what, you know, what she's done this year. So she'll have time. The judges will give her a little bit of time to just compose herself. And then her name will come up. And when they move the cone away from the front of the high jump bed area, that will mean her minute is counting down, and she then has to complete her jump within that minute of time. If she goes past it, it will be a no jump. And that probably be one of the biggest roars of the evening, because nothing is happening, nothing else is going on. There's nothing on the track. The javelin boys are still warming up, but the high jump was the absolute and total focus. And what a good clearance under pressure, because that's very close. In percentage terms, that's very close to her season's best. So well done to the Turkish high jumper, Burcu Ayhan. And the bar now will progress to 1:93. So the next best thing to being in there is to be a coach and sit on the outside and tell the girls or whoever's doing whatever they're doing in the stadium exactly what to do and exactly how to do it. It's great being a coach.
You know what I think about that system, don't you?
I wonder when you might chip in.
I would agree.
Well, both of you. in the research, there's a phrase called coach dependency.
Well, there's a lot of it going on in the Olympic Stadium, I tell you, and it shouldn't be, because the athletes, when they get to this level, should be able to maintain themselves in an event without consulting, because you can lose focus, and you know, if there's a slight disagreement, or perhaps you're not quite sure what the coach is saying, or there's a misinterpretation, then it can all go wrong as well. I'm really sorry they changed that rule. I wish they'd get rid of the coaches out of the stadium, at least not able to contact their athlete.
Yeah, I think it changed when you were able to talk over the barriers. So this is the new height. We're going to be moving to 1:93, and the first up is the first jumper on the list, and this is Svetlana Shoklina of Russia. Great clearance for her. Two circles to a name, first two heights. Looks very good. Looks good at these heights. She's jumped 201 this year, so 193 should be as easy as that one looked. And it was. Now we have coming up for her first attempt at 193, Emma Grentrego-Garo of Sweden. And this time, she takes the opportunity to go clear on her first jump. I've just been watching the wind down there a little bit, and it does look as though they may have a bit of a tailwind, something helping them into the bar. So they'll have to make the adjustments. But that's a really nice, clean attempt by the Swede. And she goes clear on her first attempt at 193.
Mo Farah then, who is in the call room waiting to be brought out into the stadium to participate in the final of the 5,000 metres, and Gebre Meskel of Ethiopia, and along with teammate Gebre Wet, they will be certainly threats in this. And we mustn't forget Bernard Lagat either. There's an awful lot to look forward to in that 5,000 metres. I just hope that somebody tries to take it on and early, and let's have a really good race rather than a ponderous first half and a negative split again. This is a championship, of course, and people don't want to lay their cards on the table, I guess, too early. But, you know, and anyway, we shall wait and see.
So this is Radziwill of Uzbekistan. And she has a failure at 193. Just clicked it with her heels. She got all of her body over that. Just, and then she just clicked it with the back of her thighs and then finished it off with a heel. So she'll have that cross against the name for the first attempt at 193. Now Ahan, who's had a bit of practice already tonight, three attempts before she went clear at 189, she comes up now to start her first preparations for the height of 193. Now this would equal her season's best and just be 1 centimetre below her personal best set in 2011. Well, she got too close to the bar on that. The run-up, I think, is just going to need some adjustment.
Well, Mo Farah again is now on the indoor warm-up area. There's his training partner, Rupp of the United States, and he's joined by Lagat, as I said. But Galen Rutt got the silver in the 10 behind his training partner here, Mo Farah. Now the men's javelin final. They've been warming up. John's mentioned that several times. We're going to get the introductions now, but it should be a cracker.
And the javelin boys are just lining up on the big screen in the stadium. They're just getting a repeat of the qualifying round throws, and 12, the top 12. 13th was Leslie Copeland from Fiji. Now that would have been a first if we'd had a Fijian in the final, perhaps. Just looking at Peter to my right, and it would have been. And we've already probably got some first, Trinidad and Tobago, Kenya. We've had two Kenyans before. I remember a good Kenyan, I can't remember his name, but he was I'm not sure about Trinidad and Tobago. Anyway, first up in the javelin will be Roderick Genki Dean, a Japanese who's got a father who resided in the northeast and a Japanese mother. Manio of Finland. We have three Finns in tonight's final, and we'll meet the others in a little bit. So Spiridon Lebesis, coached by the previous coach of Gatsiudis, one of the opponents of Mr. Backley a few years back. Veselý of the Czech Republic, who threw 88 metres on his qualifying round and leads the world this year with 88.34. Now we have Walcott from Trinidad and Tobago. He's the world junior champion. Then we have Julius Shago, who's one of the shortest javelin throwers I've seen, but what a lovely little thrower he is when he comes in and lets go. Kenyan record in the qualifying, 81.81. Pitamaki from Finland, who's got a few medals to his name over the years, but just doesn't quite look what he used to look like. But it will be interesting to see how he copes tonight. The Ukrainian, Pianetska of the Ukraine. Best of 86.12 in 2012. Stuart Farquhar, who sits in third place in the world list this year, 86.31 from New Zealand. It truly is a multinational event, the final of the javelin tonight. Tino Haber of Germany. The reigning Olympic champion from Athens and Beijing. Andreas Torkildsen from Norway. He'll be looking to win a three, a third, a triple. What a fantastic feat that would be. And then the third Finn to make up the 12 is the Finn Ruskanen, Antti Ruskanen of Finland. Yep, three throws. Top eight goes further forward for the further three throws, and it's going to be fascinating stuff. And I call it to be reasonably close competition at the top end. Somebody will go long though, and it's just waiting to happen at any time. And I have to say, three or four of these guys could go long. 88 meters would definitely win it for me. 86 might win it. We all will see very soon. All will be revealed as Dean from Japan lines up for the first throw of the competition. Well, he gets a no throw. I think the wind's going to be tricky tonight by the looks of it. It went high and it went out the sector, so he had two bits wrong with that one. And probably can't believe that it was as bad as that, the first throw of the Olympic final. I think you're exposed a bit when you're first up in the Olympic final and there's no track stuff going around you. And the women's high jump is the only event taking place at the moment. But that's what you're here for. You're here to do your business. This is Manio of Finland. First of the three Finns to throw. And he's opened up. Well, it's over 75 metres, short of 80. So the tricky wind conditions that I thought perhaps might be evident, and it might die down just a little bit, are going to be showing themselves in the flight of the implement here tonight. So Manio goes to 78.60 on his first throw, so he'll take the lead by default because he's only the second one, and the first throw was a no throw from Dean.
Well, we're underway in the field obviously, but we also of course have quite a number of victory ceremonies tonight with more and more finals taking place, and this is one that an event that happened yesterday. It was a thrilling competition too. It's the men's pole vault. Medals presented by a very famous Olympian, 110 meter hurdles champion, Guy Drou from France, who's a member of the IOC. And he's accompanied by the greatest pole vaulter of all time, Sergei Bubka, whose world records still stand far above what anybody else in the world can do. Sergei Bubka, of course, is a vice president of the IAF. Very, very high standard, and the new personal best was set by the man who's receiving the bronze medal now, Raphael Holtstepper of Germany. He cleared 5 meters 91. Thrilling competition with three men in action at that height and above. while they're short of Sergei Bubka's 6.15, 6.14 world records. He'll have been pleased to see a good standard in the event, I'm quite sure. Silver medal, clearing the same height of 5 meters 91, only on his second attempt to hold step as third. It's Bjorn Otto from Germany. But the gold medal fittingly went to the man who's been the number one pole vaulter for the last couple of years. Been in splendid form all this year. And he cleared 5 meters 97 here. Renaud Lavillenie.
Well, the 5,000 meter finalist entering, there's the champion at 10,000 meters in front of his home crowd once again, seeking a double that would be quite incredible. Won the 10,000 meters, more about that in a moment, but the crowd getting excited.
And there we have the Trinidad and Tobago athlete, who's the world junior champion, nailing his first round throw. And that has taken it past, I think, his personal best. He sticks his tongue out. 83.51 for Walcott.
National record.
Well, there you go. It's a fantastic throw. Under pressure, the excitement. There's no pressure on him, he's just going to come out and throw. And it's a bit sad that Diego's come out with a bandage around his knee, because I thought he might progress tonight as well. So, but he's tightly strapped on that left knee. So you go, Diego from Kenya, comes piling in. He's just topped that. That's such a shame, because
Had he got just his arm back and held it back and just let his body do the talking for a fraction longer, that would have been a very good throw. Very nicely lined up. So if that knee's not troubling him too much, I can see the Kenyan throwing big tonight too. Another Kenyan record could be on the cards. 72.59 for the Kenyans.
So to the men's 5,000 metre final, a journey of 12 and a half laps of this 400 metre track, and this much anticipated. And there is the lineup. Mo Farah, of course, Gebrewet of Ethiopia, Bernard Legat, look out for them. Igida, look out for him. Gebre Meskel, certainly look out for him, the Ethiopian. Then Galen Rupp, the silver medalist at 10,000 metres. And Kipsiro and Koech to make up this field. But this is the moment. What has gone before has no meaning. This is the final. 15 athletes. Koech, world youth champion a couple of seasons ago. He's still only 18. Fourth in the world championships last year, the Kenyan. Kipsiro of Uganda. The first man to make the long distance double in the Commonwealth Games. He was very quick over the last 400 as well. Kipsiro of Uganda. Fine, fine performance by Galen Rupp of the United States. US record holder, four times their champion. There's Barrios, the Mexican, Pan American champion last season. Top non-African in the last Olympic final. Well, there's Ibrahimov, Azerbaijan. Performed well in the heat, won his semi-final, in fact. Gebre Meskel, he is a real danger to everyone. He's 22 now, the world bronze medalist last year. Won the Diamond League races in Oslo and Paris with very fast last laps. Levins of Canada. Another American now. Lopez Lomong. Flag bearer for the American team in the last Olympic Games 4 years ago, incidentally. Well, Mumingala. Of Djibouti. And there is Igida. This is his fifth race, actually, in this championship. The only one to attempt the 1500, 5000 double. And now this fella's got to be watched as well. Former world champion at 15 and 5000, Bernard Lagat. He beat El Garouge on one of those occasions in one of those races as well. Gebrewet. Yes, Hagos Gebrewet. He won races in Shanghai, was second in the Diamond. Now listen to this. Never in the history of British athletics has a long-distance runner had such support. What on earth must be going through his mind? Longisiwa then. The Kenyan. Alemiru is the other, the third Ethiopian in this race. He was, first saw him in the Great Ethiopian Run, actually, a couple of seasons ago. I remember commentating on that, and he was second in that race. So, 12 and a half laps of the track. What sort of race will it be? The men's 5,000 metre final. And the crowd all erupts as the initial jostling takes place. Legat's there, Agida's there, Gebre Meskel is there now. Who's going to try and control this? Koech right on the outside, so is Kipsiro. And Mo Farah, as usual, right at the back. But don't worry about that. He'll always be in the right place at the right time when it matters, that's for sure. Kipsiro, the double Commonwealth champion, and it's very steady indeed. And this is once again going to play into the hands of the fast men. Torkelson in the javelin. Let's just break off from that race for the moment.
And he's just hit that too low. He's tried to nail it into the wind, so he'll have a no throw on that one. He was trying to hit it lower into the field, but he couldn't quite manage it.
Well, it looks as though Agida is
taking this on, but this is pedestrian. Very, very slow indeed. And we've got one of those races where somebody's got to take it on, and in fact it is, and it's Ibrahimov of Azerbaijan. He says, I've had enough of this, I'm off. And he's starting to make a true race of it, and all of a sudden one or two are realising they've got to get to grips, because Ibrahimov won his semi-final. It wasn't particularly quick, but none of them were. And Mo Farah will surely take note of that and slowly move forward as he is for the moment.
71 seconds that first lap.
Yes, indeed. Longi Sewara down at the back there as well. And all of a sudden, once again, it's steadied down and the Kenyans coming through. And Ameyu and Emiru right on the outside there. Gebre Meskel as well. They're all there, the Ethiopians at the front, all three Ethiopians in that leading group now. And Mo trailing right at the back, but this is the way he runs, out of trouble, doesn't get into trouble. The race is yet to emerge. Certainly Haley Ibrahimov of Azerbaijan was sixth in the European Championship, so he's running above himself here. Longi Sewara going right into third place now, the Kenyan. And all of a sudden the Mexican Barrios now moves up into second place, and it's beginning to hot up now as they begin to jostle for position.
Well, even though he's got a big lead, he's still slow. It's still outside, yeah. 70 seconds the laps.
Yeah, it is 71.8 I think it was the last lap. But that's this race now coming down the straight now with 10 laps to go, a little bit of a home straight plus 10 laps to go in this 5,000 metre final. As Mo Farah is right at the tail end of this race, just behind, of Lopez Lomong, the second of the Americans. Rupp is tucked in right on the inside.
And Halibut, who's had two failures at 1:93. Last attempt. Beijing champion goes clear on her last jump of 1:93. So she's still in the competition, but she was leaving it till the last minute. Clearance at 1:93.
Whilst you're away, Mo Farah moved from the back to the front. He looks very comfortable because this is the kind of race he wants. This is the kind of race that he can run off. He's got the basic speed, but so has Gebre Meskel. So has Legat. And all of a sudden, it looks like the American, the second American, Lomong, that's gone into the lead. And it is Lomong. Flag bearer at that last Olympic Games, semi-finalist in the 1500 4 years ago. Legat, now there he is, right in the middle of your screen, towards the back of the field now. And Mo Farah drops back to fourth place, but just for a moment there, just putting his seal on this race. Alamira, you can see there, Kipsiros on the outside.
Still very slow, look at that, 73.
It's playing into the hands of the speedsters again. It's going to be a 1500 meter race towards the end of this. It certainly is, there's no question about that whatsoever. This is not about time. Kipsiro looks to be in second place, and in third place is Gebre Meskel. As they stretch down that back straight, no one prepared to really put some pace into this yet. The race has yet to emerge. The tactics, the mental battles are going on. That's Ibrahimov, and there's Mo Farah, and there's the Mexican Barrios. And when they come into this straight, they will see that there are eight laps to go. Lomong takes it on. Kipsiro in, oh, and actually it's not, it's the, oh, we'll break off for the moment to Vesely.
And we have Vesely, who's coming up for his second throw in this javelin final. No throw on his first attempt. Well, it's gone over 80 metres, so, but he went very, very high, and the wind here tonight isn't suiting very high javelins unless you hit it flat and high. Now, that may seem strange, but you have to let go of it so that the point doesn't go up in the air at all. It's got to go flat in the sky. It can go high and flat, but it can't go with the point up, otherwise it will come down sooner than you want it to.
But it's certainly better than his first round effort, which did go up in the air and just come down. So Jan knows he's just missed that. 81-69, and he moves into the bronze medal position with 81-69.
We've just passed 2K, and it's very, very slow. 5.56.7.
Yeah, Lemong is leading. Coetzee is the leading Kenyan, former world youth champion, fourth in the world championships in Daegu last year. He's in second place. And behind him is Gebre Meskel. And one or two. Now Rupp is moving up towards the front now, along with Agala, Moomin Gala also up there as well. So they're all jostling for position now, with just under seven laps to go in this 5,000 metre final. Somebody soon is going to make the move, but it certainly suits Mo Farah this.
And this is Sean Woolcock, personal best in the new Trinidad and Tobago record in 83.51. What can he do on his second round throw? He looks good to me. Oh, he's got hold of that. That's nice and flat and high at the same time. Oh, wow, look, just under 85 metres. So he's saying, where's that coming from? Well, he's got some lovely flowing rhythm on that runway, and it just all comes so naturally. So he's broken the record, Trinidad Tobago record, on two throws, the first two in this final tonight. And that's going to be very close to 85. That's 84 and a half metres, I bet. He substantiates his lead at the top of the javelin. And next to go in the high jump is Shoklina of Russia. First attempt at 197. Right, she goes clear. Good clearance by her. First attempt.
Five and a half laps to go in this 5,000 metre final, and still they jostle for position. The leading Ethiopian now making his move is Alamiru. He's the man at 12.48, man at his best, but we're not looking at those sort of times here, that's for sure. Coetzee is the leading Kenyan. In second place now is Gebre Meskel. Behind him is Longisowa, then Lemong, and then Ibrahimov of Azerbaijan. And it's coming up to five laps to go now. Farah back in seventh place, but now taking close order. Here comes Gebre Meskel on the outside. He's now, what, in sixth place?
Well, 8.42.95 at 3K. A 2.46 kilometre, still slow, but much quicker than the 2.55s and the 3.01 we had to start with.
Yeah, 62.4 that last lap as they go down the back straight again. Just over four and a half laps to go. And the leader now is Gebre Meskel. He's the man, and Mo Farah must take account of him, and I'm sure he will.
Pitimäki from Finland, his second round throw, 77.33 on his first attempt tonight. Just went a bit high and came straight down. Well, it looks a bit flatter. Yep, it is. And yep, and he goes out into the silver medal position at the middle phase of the second round. So you can see that silver and bronze line there in the field. And flight is good. And that will be around 82 to 83 meters for Pitimäki. 82.68 for him in the second round.
Less than four laps to go, about three and a half, just over three and a half laps to go now in this 5,000 metre final. And the leader is Alamiru. Alamiru of Ethiopia leads. In second place is Gebre Meskel of the other Ethiopian. Let's just try and sort them out from there on in. Coetzee is running wide. He's now the leading Kenyan. Longisiwa on the inside. Mo Farah now moving wide, tracked by Kipsiro, and Legat now right on the shoulder of Mo Farah, and Mo Farah's looking to go, and Legat's trapped, and with just three laps to go, it's now going to be a race, a real race. Mo looks very, very comfortable.
Last two laps, both 61s,
61 second laps then for the last 800 metres. And it's hotting up, it certainly is, as one would expect. And also there is Ibrahimov, he's been there all the time. And Mo Farah now in second place, chasing on to Gebre Maskell. And here comes the other Kenyan, Koech, taking close order. The three Ethiopians are there. And this is going to be a cracking end to the race, certainly, as it gradually gets quicker and quicker and quicker. Gebre Maskell leads, Farah in second place. Alameru in third place. They're all bunching. Somebody's going to go. Gebre Maskell is there in fourth. Longisawa's trapped on the inside. So is Rupp. Lagat still in about eighth place. Kipsiro now making some headway as they bunch up again with just two laps to go. This is getting me down to an 800 meter race now. Now who's got the courage to go? When will they go? This is less than two laps now. And Farah's in a position to strike. And when he strikes, and he's gone. He's gone again, Mo Farah. And he's taken the lead now. And the rest follow. Gebre Meskel's behind him. Then the other Ethiopian. That's Gebrewit, as you can see. Koech is there. And they're all jostling now to get into the right place at the right time. Lagat has got himself out. Lagat, I think, moving into fourth place. And Rupp coming through into the lead now. The two training partners, gold and silver in the 10,000, lead this 5,000 metre final with a straightaway and one lap to go. Farah leads, Rupp in second place. Guido's come back into it. So has Longisiwa. It's anybody's race, this. And here we go. Farah won't give up on the inside. And this is almost, well, look at this, there's going to be a sprint for the finish now. And it's the Ethiopian Gebrewet who's taken it on, but Mo Farah's got the lead. Can he double? It would be unbelievable if he could double. Farah leads. In second place is Longisiwa, and Longisiwa's challenging. Agida's in third place. Farah and Longisiwa, these two locked together. And look at this. The Kenyans holding on, and Farah with 200 metres to go. Agida's coming wide on the outside. It's going to be a cracking last 100 metres. Can Mo Farah hang on to this? He's got eyeballs out now. Longisiwa in second place. Agida there. Lagat coming wide. He got tripped though. And Mo Farah's coming down the straightway. And he's going to be attacked by Gebre Maskell, and Mo Farah's got the double! He's the Olympic champion again. Gebre Maskell gets the silver medal, and in third place is the second of the Kenyans. And what about that? Mo Farah is the Olympic 10,000 meter champion. He's the Olympic 5,000 meter champion. He is a man of the moment, and Great Britain have another gold. A sensational run by Mo Farah off a slow pace. But my goodness me, when it came to the sprinting, well, they played once again into his hands. Gebre Maskell couldn't match him. But Farah is at the top of his game. Come on, Mo. Show him you've got more. Wonderful, wonderful double. Wonderful double for Britain's top distance man. He came to these championships given a chance. He's gone away from these championships as the champion, as the gold medalist. Gebre Maskell real couldn't quite get there, could he? Longisiwa got the bronze, the Kenyan, as I said. But my goodness me, this British crowd have been treated to another night of exceptional distance running when it comes to it. Tactical race, yes it was. A good race, yes it was. But they played into Mo Farah's hands again.
And the most staggering noise I think I've ever heard in a stadium throughout the closing laps, particularly the last lap. Well, the figures are that Farah ran the last lap. I've got him in 52.9. A 26 and a half seconds, and then a 26.3 as he really fought. And he joins the immortals, the men who've won both the 5 and 10. He joins Kenenisa Sebekele, Mirat Jifta, Lassie Viren, Vladimir Kutz, Emil Zadipek, and Hannes Kolomainen on doing the double at an Olympic Games.
And that is not an easy thing to do. Let's look at the final stages here. Longisewa was right on his shoulder. Aguida was threatening. Gebre Meskel got trapped on the inside. That was his problem. He was in the wrong place at the wrong time. And he had to move out and wide to get past Longisewa to get the silver medal. But Farah was away and there was no way back at all. And Legat coming through into fourth place was always in the wrong place. Got trapped. But Mo Farah, the champion, the Olympic champion, twice over, champion at 10, champion at 5, he is the king. Wonderful, wonderful moment in front of a massive home crowd for this young fella who has tried so hard to get the belief, and he has that belief. Three or four seasons ago he wouldn't have had this belief, but he's developed it. And he's got himself into the record books, into Olympic history, and that is quite something. An incredible evening already here in London. Wherever you are in the world, morning, evening, nighttime, you really can't say that this was not a fine hour for this young Briton. Another look at this wonderful historic moment for British long distance running. A man who came here with the potential, a man who went, who came away with more than that. He came away with the credibility by beating the very best that the world could offer at home.
And with the whole of the field there together, he took the lead at 700 meters to go, quite a long way out. He increased the tempo over that 300 meters before he came to the bell, and then he really poured it on all over that last 400. Meanwhile,
Torkelsen in the javelin, no throw on his first attempt, just trying to hit it too low. Comes down, he ducks his head away. I don't like that with Torkelsen. He's better when he keeps his head up and watches the javelin go from his hand. It's better. It's going to be over 80 meters. It's probably over 82 meters, actually, just looking at it in the sector. Yep, you can see it's very close to the silver medal mark. And Torkelsen in, you can see left shoulder down, head down, and he just keeps his hand up, luckily for him, and he gets a bit of flight on that javelin into this stadium air tonight. But he goes over the bronze medal, so he's going to be in that bronze medal position. Pulls the face at Coach Osmond in the stand, 82-63. And he does go into that bronze medal position. Chikarova of Russia attempting 197 on her first attempt. Oh, good speed, nice speed around the turn as she comes around into the takeoff area, takeoff zone. Great high knee lift on that right. Right shoulder stays up, and she's got a very tidy clearance at 1 meter 97. She's clear all the way through so far. Alibut, and this is her first attempt at 1.97. She had a bit of a scare at 1.93, went clear on her third attempt. Oh, she's over 1.97. That equals her best for 2012, and she'll be the one they'll be celebrating. You can bet if she goes clear at it any higher, because she's a good celebrator. Just clear at 1.97, but it's the first attempt, and coach in the stands thinks that's pretty good too. So good clearance for Alibut on 1.97.
Well, there was the finish of this epic final sprint by Mo Farah to complete the double here. 10,000 metres early in the games, and now the 5,000 metres. He really is the complete distance runner, and he now joins those five men who previously won the 5,000 metres and the 10,000 metres. And it's the first British gold medalist ever at this event, and the first to get a medal since Ian Stewart way back in Munich in 1972. Piri got a silver in 56, and now Farah gets the gold. Young man, of course, who was born in Somalia but has lived all his developed life in Britain.
There it is, Mo Farah, 13:41.66. Gebre Meskel, Ethiopia, 13:41.98. And Longis Siwa of Kenya, 13:42.36. Wonderful, wonderful final. That's how the rest finished. They jostled for position all the way through until the last two laps, when it was down to the power and the sprinting of this man. And he prevailed in the end in a manner that will be celebrated in this stadium for some time, and he'll be on the front pages of all the journals tomorrow. Wonderful, wonderful moment. Mo Farah, look at how generous is that. He just won, and he appreciated the support that the fans gave him. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful.
And in the javelin, we have coming up Piatnitsa of the Ukraine, who had 81-61 on his second throw. That puts him in the top eight at the moment. And he decelerates, but I tell you what, that's lined up very nicely indeed. And he's whipped it through. It's just below Wolcott's throw of 84-58, which leads the competition at the moment. The surprise leader from Trinidad and Tobago with that new national record. And the Ukrainian comes in, and although he collapses on it, it's lined up perfectly at the back, and he just gets a bit of beef behind it. Flat in the sky, you can see that that's scything through the air, and that's just going to be below the Trinidad and Tobago athlete's throw of 84-68. 84-15, he goes second as we start, 84-51 as we go into the final throws on the third round.
And Mo Farah greets his family. His wife and daughter there.
Well done, darling. You got any dinner tonight? What's for dinner? Wonderful, isn't it? Sort of family moment. Come with us, Mo, they're saying. Please come with us.
Yes,
he's going to do what he wants to do, and so he deserves it.
She's quite heavily pregnant with their second child, so I hope she doesn't have too exciting moments this evening. You know, one tonight is enough. Now, this is Haber of Germany. He's out of the top eight at the moment. A lot of speed on the runway, a bit untidy, but he stops before that foul line. Oh, and look, it's over 80 metres. So Haber of Germany will be making the cut with that sort of distance. There's only two throws that follow him. So an 80 metre throw now is very well timed indeed for the German. He wasn't going to make the cut with what he'd had so far. 81-21 for Haber. Now Torkelsen is on the runway for his third attempt. 82-63 on his second throw. I've got a funny feeling here. I think he's going to launch this one. I really do think he's going to launch it. It's how hungry he is. I think this one could go. Well, I don't know what happened to that.
Well, three throws to go for Torkelsen, but now we come to the women's 1500 metres victory ceremony. Again, an event held last night. A little bit of history made in this event as well. Medals presented by Dr. Usur Erdener from Turkey, fittingly. Member of the IOC. And accompanying him, one of the all-time great athletes, uniquely the double winner of the 800 and the 400 in Montreal in 1976, Alberto Wantarena, who's a council member of the IAAF. And the bronze medal went to the former double world champion, Mariam Jamal from Bahrain. Uniquely, gold and silver medals going to Turkey. First of all, Gamzi Bulut taking the silver. Bulut, who'd earlier been the silver medalist also in the European Championships. And the order turned out to be identical in those European Championships to here in the Olympic Games. Gold medalist and the first Turkish woman gold medalist in the history of athletics at the Olympic Games, Asli Kakia of Turkey. Well, what a moment, and what a moment in Turkish athletics. They had a brilliant European Championships, and it's turning out to be brilliant Olympic Games as well. They are a nation that have made huge progress. But the field event's going on, and the high jump bar, we're now up to 2 metres, John.
Yep, 2 metres. Skolina of Russia, she's been clean every time at the three early heights. Oh, and she goes clear first time again at 2 metres. Well, you know, it's going to take somebody that's jumping better than her to win the gold tonight, I think. Really rangy on the run-up, cuts her stride down, but doesn't lose any speed into the bar. And what a great clearance at 2 metres. So this is Chikarova, her teammate, going first time for 2 metres. That, and she goes clear as well by an absolute country mile. So again, nice rhythm around that bend to the takeoff point, very firm on the takeoff, great leg lift, knee lift on the free leg, and she just rolls over that bar. So she's clear as well. So her, the two Russians at the moment, going absolutely neck and neck in this high jump final.
And now we have come back to the track again, and it's the final of the women's 800 meters. Well, those are the stats. We're not going to approach those times, I don't think. The world record having stood for nearly 20 years. But we have a fascinating lineup here. And there it is. Poistigova of Russia. Leon Saba of Burundi. Johnson Montagno of USA. Savinova of Russia. Jalimo, Kenya. Semenya, South Africa. Jepkoskai of Kenya. And Azakova of Russia. So on the inside, the Russian champion this year, Yekaterina Poistigova, made huge progress this season, from outside 202 to a 157.93. New personal best, a youngster, 21. Even younger, this is the youngest in the field, 19-year-old Francine Nyansaba. And in her first year of 800-meter running, she's come all the way down to 158.67. Then Alicia Johnson Montaigne from the USA, third in the world indoors, fourth in the world championships last year. Maria Sivinova has been the world number one the last couple of years, European champion, then world champion, former world indoor champion as well, plenty of honours to her. Pamela Gyalimo, well, is she back into the form she showed when she won the title in 2008 and won all her races that year, including the Golden League $1 million jackpot. Caster Semenya, the controversial South African who was the world champion in 2009, knows a lot of form this year, eighth in Rome and ninth in Monaco, until suddenly she produces a 157 in her semi-final. Janet Jepkoskai-Busieniai of Kenya, former Commonwealth champion, gold, silver and bronze in the last three world championships. Then we have Yelena Arsakova, a very impressive winner of the European title this season. 157.67. Well, fastest in the field is Gyalimo this year at 156.76. And then from Montaño and Savinova. Fascinating race. The former champion, Gyalimo. Jepkoskai, the runner-up in Beijing. Semenya, former world champion. And they're off in the women's 800 metres. Rather slow start for the Burundian newcomer, Nyansaba, and she's got time to make that up. And with the flower in her hair, it's Montaño of the USA showing initially first here. Gyalimo just behind her, and then coming across from the outside, Jepkoskai, who at her peak always used to like to front run. So Montaño it is from Jepkoskai. Those two going a little clear of the rest of the field at the moment at this early stage in the race. It's pretty quick as they pass through the 200 meter point. There's Savinova and Semenya at the moment, just a second from the back of this lineup. So Montaño, who went an amazing 55 and a half in her heat. She's running a little more conservatively now, but not much. As behind her, we've got Busanai, Jepkoskai there. Gyalimo on the inside, the Burundian just after that, Poistegova and Savinova fourth and sixth. Well, 56.31, it is quick.
Yeah, it's very quick indeed, isn't it? The American responsible for that, Jepkoskai in second place, and I just wonder, Semenya now has dropped right off the back. This is extraordinary, running 157 in qualification. And here comes Gyalimo, Pamela Gyalimo, and she's away with about 280 metres to go, and it really is a break as well.
Well, she looks very good indeed. She comes up to the 600 meter point now, 125.89. That's very fast indeed. And here come the Russians, though, led by the long striding Savinova. Savinova and then Arsakova. Savinova gaining ground rapidly on Gyalimo. She's up onto her shoulder as they swing into the home straight now. Maria Savinova, who came to this race as the favorite. Semenya's now making up a lot of ground from the back, but flying down the home straight. And she's going to win by a huge margin. It's Savinova of Russia who wins. Jepkoskai is tying up, and here comes Semenya lumbering along to come into second place there, and the other Russian, Poistegova, just dips, and I think she gets Gyalimo, with Montaño, who took the early lead there, finishing in fifth place in that race. Well, I think that's a well-deserved victory for Savinova. She's been the world number one for a couple of years. Gyalimo made the burst with a little less than 300 meters to go, and then she caught up Gyalimo, did Savinova at 200, and came well clear.
Yeah, 156.19 then for it's a season's best for her. Semenya 157.23. What a strange way to run the race. Looked as though she'd got a mile of running in her left. It was an extraordinary way to run the race. And she gets the silver medal ahead of Poistegova of Russia. 157.23 to 157.53. That was Poistegova's personal best, actually.
And here we have Lowe, Shante Lowe of America. First attempt at 2 meters. Oh, and it's down for Low. So, sorry, that could be her second attempt. We'll just check that. So, high point, definitely not high enough to get that. Arch getting over the bar, didn't quite get up there. So that's her first attempt, first failure at 2 meters. This is Beata at 2 meters. Well, and she goes clear. So the European champion from 2012 goes clear first time at 2 meters. That exaggerated lean we talked about earlier, but it seems to be having the effect. Doesn't disturb her flow and her run-up. So good clearance from Bayita. First time clearance. And now this is Brigitte Barrett of the USA. It's her second attempt at 2 meters. Good speed, hands joined together as she comes in. And yep, I think you can safely say that was a celebration on the bed, because she goes clear at 2 meters on her second attempt. Excellent clearance from the American. And we'll just catch up with the graphic here, hopefully, just to see where that 2 meters with count back applied, where she's ending up at the moment in the competition. Because this high jump will become a bit of a chess game if four or five go over 2 meters. Yet she's in fourth position at the moment with that clearance. So good clearance by Barrett of America.
Well, we're still having lots of victory ceremonies, including catching up on yesterday's events. And this is the women's hammer, which is the one next to place. A very, very high quality competition. It featured the last four world champions, the last three world record holders. And we got the Olympic record broken a couple of times in the final as well. Not without incident either, as a crucial throw, the bronze medal throw, in fact, was lost in the system for a while, but fortunately was able to be found, and the help of video analysis to confirm it. Now, for this event, Thomas Bach from Germany, the vice president of the IOC, is to make the presentation, and accompanied by another German dignitary, Helmut Diegel, council member of the IAAF. So the bronze medal going to Betty Heidler of Germany, the world record holder. Now, she only had one good throw, but it was 77 meters 13, and for a while it was lost in the system. She was given another throw, or she fouled that, but in fact, fortunately, there was more than enough evidence to confirm that she had indeed done a big throw, and she got the bronze medal. Well, the Chinese, whose athlete came fourth, protested. Said the athlete didn't know what she got to do on the last throw, but I think most of the competitors must have realized that Heidler had that big throw, and quite rightly she has got the bronze medal. Former world champion, of course. So all the three medalists here have held the world record at some stage. So we now have the silver medal going to the world champion of 2009, Anita Vladacek, who held the world record at 78.30 in 2010. All these three champions, in fact, world champions and world record holders between them. Vladacek, who injured herself celebrating her victory, in fact, in the World Championships. The gold medal going to an athlete who had to serve a drunk suspension at one time. He is a very fine athlete indeed. World champion last year, former European champion, and now Olympic champion, Tatiana Lysenko. Olympic record at 78 meters 18. Ever since she first appeared and won the European title in 2006, people have commented on a tall, slim athlete who can throw the hammer, Great athleticism. Looking on with pleasure, two more Russian medalists here today. That's the two 800 meter runners, Savinova and Puistegova.
And here we have Ruskinen of Finland for his fifth round throw. Good pace on the runway. Can't quite stand up at the end, but that's flying out there. That's just over, I would think, around the 84 mark. It's just below that gold medal throw so far that Walcott of Trinidad and Tobago holds the lead. And he stands up off that left foot and then crumbles to a heap at the end, but he's still looking. So he tried to keep his head up. And that's going to put him up in the medal positions. There's no doubt about that. 84-12, so he goes into the bronze medal position in the fifth round of the javelin. Shante Love, the USA, for her third attempt at 2 meters. Oh, and that was a good attempt, but it goes down. So Lowe is out of the high jump at 2 meters. And Alibo of Belgium for her third attempt at 2 meters. Good speed. Oh, she just clips it off on a third attempt. So the reigning Olympic champion goes out. She bows to the crowd, applauds them because they helped to get up over 197. Skolina at the new height of 203. First attempt. And that's the first failure that Skolina of Russia has had in this competition. So that could expose her, because Shikharova, her colleague and compatriot, has had clear jumps just like her up to 2 meters. So if Shikharova goes clear, then she'll have the ace card on her fellow compatriot, Skolina. Shikharova is next up to jump. Oh, what a great clearance from the Russian. She's probably got the longest legs in the competition, and she certainly looks as though she might be the tallest, but that's a great clearance by the Russian. So she will go into the lead with the first time clearance at that height. And the only one then to come in and challenge them will be the Spaniard, Baita.
Well, Chicharova, I think, was always the favorite with the best, of course, of 207. Let's see whether Baita can match it.
Exaggerated lean. Nope.
She doesn't have the sort of flowing qualities of the Russian girl on the run-up. She just sort of flows into the takeoff point, and Baita's looks more constructed. It looks like it's been sort of built as opposed to being rhythmically created.
Well, here's the finish of the 800 metres. This is the point at which Savinova went past Gelimo, looking ahead, looking up at the giant screen, which is she comes into the home straight. Both the athletes can see ahead, and Savinova's looking up that screen and seeing her own delight in reaching the finishing line, because she sees that there's no one going to get past that. Gelimo ties up a little bit at the end there as Semenya comes along to finish fast. And there's the result of the 800 meter. The gold medal going to Maria Savinova of Russia, a very fast 156.19, the fastest in the world this year. Kasta Semenya taking the silver medal for South Africa, and Poistegova of Russia the bronze.
And in the javelin, we have Tino Harper from Germany with his sixth round throw. So this will be the start of the final round in the javelin. And it goes out to the right-hand side of the sector. It's not going to improve on what he's thrown tonight, so he'll end up in eighth position. Good speed, but then just loses his head position. He just sort of throws down on the left-hand side instead of continuing through the left-hand side, then up and off that left side in the delivery. So he'll hold his head down, but he's thrown reasonably well tonight. He'll have his best throw of and 81-21 in the third round. It put him into the top eight, and he sort of decelerated and decreased in distances as the competition went on. So this is Ruskinen, who's moved up into bronze medal position. He was seventh at the cut, so he's made an advance in these last two throws, and he's on form. Well, that one would have cut the grass, I think. It was that low. Didn't get any height on it at all. He sort of almost fell over before he released it. You can see he dives at it a little bit. Great position there, but then just falls over. And that's just bad timing for him. He had lots and lots of force, but now he's going to sit out, and he's gone into the ground, not into the air. So he's going to have to now sit patiently, because he's in bronze medal position with 84 meters 12. Now the Czech, Zalesny, passing some words of wisdom, perhaps across the barrier to Vesely of the Czech Republic, who is the world lead coming into this. He qualified with the longest throw. He had an 88-34 throw. Well, he wished he'd got that the other way around and got that tonight, and is so you can see his best effort was in the third round, 81-80. So nervous moments for all the Czech and all the Czechs in the crowd. He looks a bit short on his right foot on that one. And it's gone out there. It's his best of the night, so he's responded, but he's going to be disappointingly, he could well be out of the medals. He needs 84-12 to get that bronze medal off Ruskinen, the Finn. And let's just have a good look at it. So you can see the bronze line, so he'll move up definitely. And he's moved up to fourth, 83-34 for the Czech. So his dream of gold medal winning is over for tonight, because that was his last throw. We've still got some quality to follow, though. Anything could happen in this javelin competition in these last few throws. This is the Greek Lebedis. And he's thrown consistently well all night. And he just losing a little bit of fizz now, having thrown 81-91, again a bit short on that right foot, and you just rotate forwards too much and you don't get the elevation on release quite right, and it sticks in the ground with a very high angle of sticking in.
So 81-91, he's in seventh at the moment, and that was just over 79 metres on his sixth round throw. So the reigning Olympic champion from Athens and Beijing is going to come up for his last round. Osman, the coach. I still think he's quite capable. If he can just get the lineup and be patient, he's got all the tools in the toolbox to throw 88 metres here tonight. Woolcock, the youngster, he's the world junior champion this year. He could be the youngest ever Olympic champion if this man can't put it out there. Well, that's finished short for Torkinson, so that's a major threat that's passed by the wayside. He had an adductor injury earlier in the year and he just hasn't looked right. So at the other end of the stadium, Barrett, Brigitte Barrett in the high jump. This is her second attempt at 2.03 meters. Oh, she's gone clear. What a great jump. Can she just celebrate that? You wait and see. Wow, what a clearance from the American. She's done a plyometric session on the bed before she comes off. She's still jumping and dancing. 2.03 meters at the second attempt for Barrett. Skolina, who's had two failures now at 2.03, this is her last chance. Final attempt, 2.03. Oh, and she goes over. What a great competition this is turning out to be. This ladies' high jump. Well, that was a nervy attempt, but boy, oh boy, what a great clearance from Skolina. Well, there's only one man now that can take the gold medal off Kishorn Woolcock, the 19-year-old young man from Trinidad and Tobago, and it's this man from the Ukraine. He lies in silver medal position at the moment. Whoa! It's not enough. We have a new Olympic champion. He's the 19-year-old from Trinidad and Tobago, and if you said to me, is he going to get another throw? Well, he's got one, but I really can't believe he's going to take it.
First ever medal for Trinidad in a field event.
Well, Bietzanikskaya, 83-53. On his last round, he had a valiant attempt at it. Oh, and at the other end, we got Baita going for 2.03, her final attempt at 2.03. in this fantastic high jump competition. Oh, and she knocks it down with the hand. She psyched herself out of that. She didn't really have a go. She put her hands down, and really that doesn't help the cause at all. So the bar goes up to 2.05, and we have Skolina, who's already in place to take her first attempt at this new height. Oh, and it's a failure for her on her first attempt.
Well, three women jumping at this height matches what we had in Beijing at 2008. It's the best ever in Olympic history.
And the Russian, the other Russian in this competition. Shikharova attempting 2.05 for the first time. Oh, and I thought she was going to go over, and I think she did too. She just clipped it with her heels. Fantastic rhythm on the runway, and it wasn't repaid really by the attempt, because that looked as though she was going to go clear. From a different angle, she's over it with most of her body and then just catches it with the calves. So she's got to be a bit more vigorous on that leg flip as she goes over. So her failure first, that's the first failure she's had tonight. At 2.05.
The women's 4x400 meters relay final. Great action in the field, and this promises to be a fine race too. The 4x400 world record, of course, set by the USSR long ago. And here is the lineup. From the inside, the Czech Republic, Nigeria, Ukraine, Russia, Jamaica, United States, France, and Great Britain. The Czech Republic go in lane two. They've got three top 400-meter hurdlers, Rosolova, Bergrova, and Hezhneva, with Bartianek also. And Hezhneva, of course, the bronze medalist in the 400-meter hurdles. Then we have Nigeria, Omotosho, Odumosu, a 400-meter hurdles finalist, the Commonwealth champion, George, and Abogun Loko. Ukraine are next, the European champions this year at this event. Logvinenko, Zemliak, Yaroschuk, and Pegida. Then we have Russia, gold and silver in the last two Olympic championships. Third in the world's last year, they have Gushina, Krivoshapka, Firova, and Anchuk, the 400-meter hurdle champion, and the other three, all medalists from Beijing. Then Jamaica, Day, White, Williams, and Williams-Mills. They were the bronze medalist in Beijing, and three of that team return here, with Day the one addition to that squad. And the USA, a dream team. Dee Dee Trotter, the bronze medalist in the 400. Alison Felix, the 200 champion. Francina McCaury, a 400-meter medalist, a finalist. And Sanya Richards-Ross, the individual champion. Then France, Anacassis, Ertis, Gaillot, and Fouet. They were second in the European Championships this year. And finally, there'll be another great roar from the crowd, because this is the British team. There go Shayna Cox, Lee McConnell, Perry Shakes-Drayton, and the 400-meter silver medalist this time, gold in Beijing, Christine Ohorogu. Well, that's the lineup. Last time in Beijing, it was USA, Russia, Jamaica, with Britain fifth on that occasion. And certainly the USA, a wonderful team here in Beijing. Felix ran 48.6 and Richards 48.93 on their legs. What can they do here today? Czech Republic, Nigeria, Ukraine, Russia, Jamaica, USA, France, and Great Britain. The 4x400 meters for women. So leading off for the USA, we have Dee Dee Trotter, right back in form in the individual 400 meters. On the outside, Shayna Cox of Great Britain has gone off hard. So too the Russian in lane four. The very experienced Yulia Gushina ran the opening leg also in Beijing. And between the Americans and the Russians, Christine Day going for Jamaica. But it's a USA-Russia battle, and Cox has gone off well for Britain. But here is Dee Dee Trotter making ground with Gushina. It's a long stagger, of course, here. The next runners will have to run the first leg in bends as well. And it's Dee Dee Trotter for the USA, then Gushina. That's going to be the order at the changeover. Let's just see as the USA baton is exchanged now. Off they go. And for the USA, it's Alison Felix running the second leg. The 200-meter champion, and she's flying. Russia in second, Jamaica are in third, Ukraine are fourth. Britain with Lee McConnell there vying for all positions behind that. But Felix is out there and flying. Well, it was a brilliant opening leg by Trotter. She ran 50.5. Now Alison Felix. Well, as I said, she ran 48.6 in Beijing. She's going to do something special here if she can keep this going. For Russia in second place, it's Krivoshapka, who always goes out hard. And for Jamaica, it's Rosemary White. They're a bit clear of the field with Ukraine then. Now we have Alison Felix coming up to hand on to another 400-meter finalist in Francina McCaury. They take the baton. Felix has just run 47.9 for that leg. Staggering. She's going to go into history, surely. Russia are in second place. Jamaica with Sharika Williams in third, then Ukraine. Well, now for the United States of America, way out in front, Francina McCaury is leading. For Russia, it's Tatiana Firova. Then for Jamaica, it's Sharika Williams. Their whole field is spread out. Nothing much to choose between it except a little battle on for fifth and sixth place, which now Perry Shakes-Drayton is taking Britain there. But what a run this is for the USA. Francina McCaury will hand on to Sanya Richards-Ross. Away they go. 49-4 there for Mokorori. So it remains quick. For Russia, it's the 400-meter champion, Natalia Anchuk. For Jamaica, it's Novleen Williams-Mills. The medals are surely between these teams. And it looks like that order, with Russia then in fourth place. Christina Horogu is being urged on by the crowd back in fifth place, and Nigeria closing on her. But really now, it's Sanya Richards-Ross pouring on the steam round the final bend, with Russia in second place, Jamaica in third place, Ukraine in fourth, Britain in fifth, and here comes Sanya Richards-Ross. The Jamaicans have gained a little bit on Russia, but the order is not going to change, surely, as Sanya Richards-Ross comes home to bring the United States to a terrific triumph here. USA take the gold medal, 3:16.88. Russia in second place, Jamaica are in third place, Ukraine in fourth, Great Britain in fifth place, and the whole team come across well. 3:16.88. Richards-Ross didn't run quite so quickly there, a mere 49.2 on the last leg, but Alison Felix, 47.9, and both Felix and Richards-Ross go into the history books, because they have each now won four Olympic medals, and indeed Alison Felix has just won her third gold medal of these championships, and her fourth in all, to equal the all-time women's athletics record set by Fanny Blankers-Kern in London in 1948. A little bit of history.
Yes, indeed. But that was a superb race indeed. In fact, it turned into a superb demonstration. But you're quite right, Alison Felix, the winner of the 200. Just imagine what she could have done in the 400 as well, because she is a 400 specialist as well. But let's go back to the high jump as it reaches its climax.
Chikorova, Russia. This is her second attempt at 2.05. Oh, wow, she's over it. Now she's got a personal best of 2.07, but that was set in 2011. She's jumped 2.03 this year, so it's a season's best. 2.05, she goes clear on her second attempt. Now the pressure's on. Soklina of Russia, the compatriot of Chikorova, who's gone clear. This is her third attempt at 2.05. Oh, and she just touched it and tickled it, and down it goes. She's got a personal best tonight of 2.03, but she goes out and she's currently in that bronze medal position. Barrett, so you can see in bronze on countback, that is. If Barrett goes clear, then obviously she's got a clear silver, but she'll get the silver if she fails this height on countback. So Barrett, final attempt. Oh, and that's down as well. So there's only one girl left in the competition. The gold medal goes to Russia. They also get the bronze with Skolina, and Barrett picks up the silver. But Chikorova of Russia clears 2.05, and it will be interesting to see if she goes for any further heights in this competition, or whether it's just been an emotional roller coaster. We've had a fantastic competition. And down at the other end, this 19-year-old youngster from Trinidad and Tobago, Keyshawn Woolcott, is the new Olympic champion for 2012. London 2012, 84.58. Now, if somebody had said to him before he came to this championships, you're going to be the Olympic champion, son, he would have said, look, I'm just here to really just learn from my experiences. But he's walked away with the gold medal. He came into this championship with a best of 82.83, which he threw this year. He won the World Junior Championships in 2012, so just recently in Barcelona. And he now is the Olympic champion. And here it is, Woolcott, Trinidad and Tobago, the first ever gold medal for that island in this javelin, 84.58. Pyatnitskaya from the Ukraine in second place with that throw of 84.51. And the bronze medal goes to Ruskinen, the Finn. The Finns win yet another medal in a World Olympic Games. And he threw 84.12 meters. Torkelsen, the reigning Olympic champion, came sixth. And he was just nipped into sixth place by Pitomaki, who came fifth.
Well, the triumph for the 4x4s and the high jumpers here, of course. It's But who would have thought that Walcott would win the javelin? That's the biggest surprise of these Olympic Games athletics.
Well, I have to admit, no, we had a conversation.
John, you told me he will want to watch a full tribute to John, who really knows about his javelin throwing.
We had a conversation before the event tonight, and I was just pretty certain that it was going to be an unusual competition potentially, and that the two youngsters, the Trinidad and Tobago athlete and the Kenyan, were going to perhaps get a good position in the final.
But meanwhile, the high jumpers celebrate. Well, what a tremendous clearance by Barrett, the American, who's added 0.2 to a personal best. Anna Chicharova, of course, was always the favourite, but it was an event that lived up to her highest expectations, I think, because 2.05 meters and then a couple at 2.03 is as good as we've ever had, or almost as good as Beijing when it was 2.05, 2.05, 2.03. So the gold medal going to Anna Chicharova, 2.05. The silver to Brigitta Barrett, 2.03. And the bronze to Svetlana Shkolina at 2.03. With Beitia, 2 meters in what I think may be her final season of competition.
And just add to that, Tina Hulabut, the reigning Olympic champion, finished in fifth position. So an admirable appearance from her in this final. And she was competitive all the way up to 197. So
indeed, as we look back now on the 4x400 meters, a triumph for the USA, who ran 3:16.87 here. I described it at the beginning as pretty much a dream team. Trotter, Felix, McCrory and Richards Ross. So double gold here for Richards Ross, treble gold for Alison Felix. The United States taking the gold in 3:16.87. From Russia, 3:20.23, and Jamaica, 3:20.95. Ukraine, Britain, France, the Czech Republic, but Nigeria were disqualified, although, of course, they were some way out of contention. Well, once again, here in the Olympic Stadium, almost every event rising to at least the minimum expectations that we had of it, and we've had some superb competitions in event after event, and the 4x1 was one of those. It was one of those very clear-cut victories, but the manner of it was special. And Alison Felix certainly stamping herself as one of the all-time great athletes, no doubt about that. She was fifth in the 100 meters, she won the 100 meters, she's got gold in both relays. The Jamaicans, well, they ran exceptionally well as well to get a medal once again. The Jamaican team of Day, White, Williams and Williams-Mills. The Americans going on the lap of honour. Of course, we've still got more relay thrills to come because we've got the 4x100 meters for men yet to come. And that's surely going to be one of the very special events here in these London 2012 Games. Once again, the weather has been very kind to us today. It's a little cooler than we had last night. It's a little windier, but it's still pretty decent conditions for outstanding athletics. We're often used to having Olympics in very, very hot weather. Well, it's a bit more temperate here in Britain, but you have to say that after the terrible summer we've had in Europe, it's been pretty good conditions. And now we look again at this 4x400, Trotter handing over to Felix, and what a leg she produced, because I timed her in 47.9. Absolutely fantastic run. Felix handing over to McCrory, and then Richards Ross running them home, entirely on her own, of course, with no challenge. McCrory, I've got in 49.4, and Richards Ross in 49.1. So splendid individual efforts to take the USA to yet another victory in the event, and that's their sixth overall in Olympic history.
It was interesting to see the lineup, wasn't it? To Trotter, who's well placed in the individual, and then handing over to Alison Felix in the second round to establish a lead.
Yes,
to get them out of the way and out of trouble.
I think whoever they'd started off with, they've got the lead, I think.
And
Felix, of course, running in the second leg just as you had in Beijing. Yeah.
It does create daylight, though. It does make everybody then have to chase. And as long as you've got the speed in your legs, you can run from the front what you'd expect to run. It's when things happen on the way and you get stopped in your tracks and there's a difficult changeover that you cause problems.
Meanwhile, I just mentioned the 4x100 is to come. And here are some of the leading contestants, the Jamaicans and the Americans, of course, we expect to contest the gold and silver. And here they are in the warm-up.
Yeah, indeed. The Americans have brought in Tyson Gay, and the Jamaicans have brought in, believe it or not, someone called Usain Bolt. And he will run the last leg against Ryan Bailey, who is the other American. There's Tyson Gay, the just out of the medals in the 100 metres, didn't contest the two because he'd been injured and hadn't fully recovered. He's very, very disappointed to come out of the medals in the 100 metres. But his comeback has been, I guess, realistic after the hip operation that he had and the problems that he had. But Usain Bolt has had no such problems. He's had some problems, a little bit of a dip in his performance prior to the games, but he went away, got himself sorted out, and has come back and shown exactly what he can do. 9.63, 19.32. He loves that camera in that warm-up straight. And of course, the Jamaican team, Nesta Carter, Michael Frater, Johan Blake and Usain Bolt. What a quartet.
And it's the same team that won in Daegu last year, so they're used to running together as well.
Yeah, the only person missing is Asafa Powell, who ran the last leg in the Olympic Games in 2008. So, you know, they've got all the options, haven't they?
They brought Johan Blake in instead of Asafa Powell. It's not bad, is it?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
There's the Jamaican 4x4 quartet. They ran very, very well, but they were up against the super team with the USA.
Yes, Alison Felix, that 47.9. Well, she's run 21.69 for 200 metres, so I can believe that sort of time. Look at them, the opening runners, the start-up runners. That's, that's Nesta Carter, I think. Oh, no, it's not. That is Michael Frater. Well, that's Justin Gatlin coming in. He'll be the second, just looking at their team, the second runner. He'll do the long back straight for the United States.
That's the same leg he ran when he got a medal back in 2004 as well.
he's now doing the... the Mo Farah, they say. He is unbelievable.
Anything
he really
Mo
is.
Can do.
He's doing it's wonderful stuff, isn't it? He's looking through there and saying, you do a couple of sit-ups, I can do those.
It's interesting to me because the woolly hats have come back on. That's what's making me chuckle. You know, the sun came out 3 days ago for the 200 metres and they're in their T-shirts. 2 days before that for the 100, they were in their woolly gear and the wetsuits and the woolly hats. Woolly hats back on.
Yeah. Australia have a side as well. Anthony Alozi. Isaac Kimitoa. Miamoa, I should say. And then Andrew McCabe and Joshua Ross. Guess who that is? That is Johan Blake just moving away. Well, the world record stands at 37.04. It's very windy out there. But in the meantime, whilst we wait for that final, it's the women's victory ceremony for the 800 metres.
Yes, well, we have a lot of victory ceremonies today because, of course, we've got to finish all the events today because this is the last day of athletics. Part, of course, from the marathon in the centre of London tomorrow. So we won't obviously have any victory ceremonies laid until the following day, as we've had throughout the earlier part of these games. Well, the superpowers of athletics, the USA and Russia, are at the head of affairs. Britain doing pretty well there as well. So the medals presented by Mr. Juan Antonio Samaranch Jr. of Spain, member of the IOC, following in his father's footsteps, of course. And Mr. Junki Park, council member of the IAF, accompanying him. Well, the bronze medal going to a young lady, 21, who's made very, very big progress this year from outside 202 as a best to a 400, 1500, and now a bronze medal in the women's 800 metres. Yekaterina Puistegova of Russia. Silver medal going to a former world champion who displayed very mixed form, some very poor form in Diamond League races, but producing a very fast time when it mattered here in the Olympic Stadium, both in the semi-final and in the final. The silver medal goes to Caster Semenya of South Africa. The world number one in the last couple of years, deservedly taking the gold medal here, Maria Savinova of Russia, winning by a very big margin too. Well, nearly overcome by emotion at the end of it there, Maria Savinova. Well, she's added a world title to a whole series of gold medals that she's won in major events, European and world indoor titles before, of course. And there's the medalists, Savinova, Semenya and Puistegova. Meanwhile, the 4x100 men leaving the call room.
Yes, they are. The showman, ever the showman. With a very serious endeavour to undertake very shortly. And the Australian quartet will lead them out. Alozi, Ntiamar, McCabe and Ross. But, here they come. Leg four, each of the legs being brought out separately. Well, the organisation has been absolutely terrific. It's all gone very much to time, and I guess these are always nervous moments, aren't they? And the fourth leg, there's the big man. Comes out with a tire that matches the cool evening, because it has temperature has dropped dramatically this evening. And it's quite windy too. It's the first time that we've had a really big wind in this stadium, and I hope it doesn't affect the performances of these teams. Remember, the Jamaican women were beaten by the United States yesterday, and the crowd looking forward to this final act of this final day, final session of the athletics here in the Olympic Stadium. Difficult to concentrate sometimes. But each of the legs of this 4x4 being maneuvered into position, check marks being taped down, 10 meter acceleration zone, and then you've got, you mustn't pass the baton in that, then you've got a box within which the baton must be passed. And that's why the local team, well, the national team of Great Britain failed to deliver the baton at the right time. Too late, out of the end of the box, and so they were disqualified. Canada, actually, in this final, were well beaten by Britain. If they'd have got that baton round, then it might have been a different story. However, that's not what happens in the games. And Usain Bolt now just even gets a massive applause for jogging down the home straight, but I tell you what, it won't be jogging when he gets the baton.
If we look at the history of this event, the USA the USA have won 15 gold medals and 2 silver, Jamaica just 1 gold and 1 silver, but really it's moved on from the USA's complete dominance to Jamaica in the last few years.
Yes, it has. And I just wonder whether that will be the same. But remember always, you've got to get the baton round. It's all right having 4 really fast guys, but you have to get the baton round. And the one thing they'll always say to you as coaches, they'll say, what's important is the baton speed. The baton speed. They have to get, it's a non-visual relay, which means that the check marks are set. And the outgoing athlete must run, and they have a predetermined predetermined number of strides. Out goes the hand, and the baton should be placed down. Most of them use the alternate method, and that Johan Blake has got the third leg, and he will hand to Usain Bolt. So I guess they're working on the basis that if they need to make up a bit, then they've got two guys who are quite capable, assuming they can get the baton into a hand. Little nervous look there from the Canadian Justin Warner. Now they're just having a little check now on that final change. It's a sort of a sprint start situation there, look, and then they go, off they go, and just rehearse that little movement. But it's so important to get that baton down into the hand, a steady hand.
Yeah, the confidence you've got to have is that you start on the mark, because that's what you've been practicing. We saw from the youngster in the British team yesterday, Gamili, that he started too soon. And Pickering did the same thing in Beijing. They had a silver tape that they used in Beijing when they gave the athletes to mark their marks. And the silver tape, he couldn't see it in the floodlights. It was bizarre. It was just one of those strange things. When he looked around to check when the race started, he looked for the mark and he couldn't see it, and he just went when he thought he should go. So the mark was immaterial, basically.
Yeah, that was Tyson Gay. And Johan Blake having a chat with some of the volunteers down at trackside. And now the preparations begin. This final event in the stadium, the men's 4x100 meters relay. The world record is Jamaica's, set in Daegu last year. We'll look now at the lineup of the teams as they go into this final. There they are, 37.04, the Olympic record 37.10, set in Beijing last year. Australia drawn in lane two, France in three, Japan four, Canada five, Jamaica six, the USA seven, Netherlands eight, Trinidad and Tobago in lane nine. Well, there are two very, very fine teams. Who will have the best baton changes? Can the Americans make up a little bit of give that they have in individual pace with at least two of the Jamaican athletes here? Nesta Carter will lead off the Jamaican side. Gatlin will run the second leg for the United States. He'll take over from Trell Kimmins. The Americans yesterday broke the record, the national record, which has stood since 1992. The Australians, Losey, Moore, McCabe, and Ross, sixth in the Olympic Games in 2004. They equaled the Oceania record yesterday, incidentally. The French, silver medalist in the World Championships last year, were third in the European Championships in Barcelona just prior to these championships. Japan, Yamagata, Eriguchi, Takahiri, and Izuka, fourth in the Olympic Games in 2004. They do tend to run well as a team. They're well coached. The Canadian team of Gavin Smellie, Rosely Smith, and Jared Connaughton, and Justin Warner. They were sixth in the Olympic Games last year. They were beaten by Great Britain in the qualification, but of course, Britain didn't get the baton in the takeover area. Nesta Carter, Michael Frater, Johan Blake, Usain Bolt. An unbelievable reception for a quartet that is, well, let's say formidable. The USA, Trell Kimmins, yesterday broke the US record, which has stood, as I said, since 1992. Justin Gatlin to Tyson Gay on the bend, and then Ryan Bailey has the job of contesting the final leg, assuming the baton gets to him, with Usain Bolt. The Netherlands, with Martina, Codrington and Van Lid, European champions. They set a national record in the heat yesterday. And then the Trinidad team, it's the same team that took silver medal 4 years ago in Beijing. Ledman, Burns, Callender and Thompson, they were seventh in the 2004 Olympic final. So they're always there or thereabouts. So the Jamaicans have the advantage of one lane inside the United States. Who will prevail? Australia, France, Japan, Canada, Jamaica, USA, Netherlands and Trinidad. The Olympic men's 4x100 meters relay final. Crowd roars and the cameras flash, and a very good run by the American Trell Kimmins. He's gone very strongly indeed. Now then, the Jamaicans have got it, so have the Americans, and Gatlin's made a bit of headway down the back straight there, and it's USA from Jamaica at the moment. Very, very strong indeed, but here goes the Jamaican changeover was terrific, and all of a sudden you've got Tyson Gay versus Johan Blake, and Blake's winning this one, and here comes Usain Bolt. He has the baton, and it's Bolt versus Ryan Bailey, and Usain Bolt is moving away, and Jamaica retain their title, 36.85, and the world record has been taken apart. Oh, I say, what a way to finish an Olympic Games. The world record has gone. That is an astonishing time, 36.85. That is unbelievable. And a national record for the United States, 36.84. It's been rounded down. Well, what can you say? Nesta Carter, Michael Frater, Johan Blake, Usain Bolt, for the second Olympic Games running, smash the world record. They've also smashed the record that they set in Daegu last year to go sub
37 seconds is incredible. That was an absolutely sensational performance. And at this stage, I have to say that I do not know who came third.
I'll tell you, I think it was Canada, but of course it was a very long way behind. A sensational performance there, and the baton changing, Frater to Blake in particular.
Oh,
it was absolutely fantastic.
Superb.
John's got the last 100 metres in 9.22 there.
Well, no, I'm just saying the average of all the average of all of them is 9.22.
And that's, of course, three flying starts, but one from start as well. So, no, it was just a sensational performance. And yet again, what a games we're having. Three world records. World records are very scarce now. And this was absolute majestic, a world record in the sprints again. It has got cooler in London here today. It's not ideal conditions of sprinting. What is ideal is the fantastic teams we've got here, not only the Jamaicans, but the Americans as well, of course.
Yep, and what a way, I repeat, what a way to finish an Olympic track and field program. Absolutely unbelievable. Unbelievable. I hope there's not a problem here. I hope there's not been a disqualification. If well, there has, well, hang on a moment, there could be. That's okay. What's wrong with that? Nothing. Well, I hope there isn't a disqualification, because that would ruin this event, certainly. Now then.
Unless it's way down some other team, of course.
Well, there's a, that's okay. That's all right. There's nothing wrong with that at all.
No, no, incredibly safe.
Totally safe.
And way, way, way down, a fine leg by the Canadian there, Justin Warner, to take that silver medal there from Trinidad and France.
Absolutely. I don't know whether they were trying just to move them off the track or what, but there's a discussion going on, most definitely.
Well, let's savour some, before we sort all that out, let's savour absolute brilliance there in sprinting, whatever.
I think there is a problem, you know, because Usain Bolt is really remonstrating over the far side. Now, we don't know why.
No, I think I might know this. They tried to take the baton off him when he finished the race. And if you like that, officials just come back with two batons. So I think Usain's walked off with the baton, so it could be that.
Oh, right. Okay. Thankfully. thankfully. Because I do not want to see a great moment ruined. That is confirmed then, isn't it? Absolutely wonderful stuff. We've come here and we've seen the Jamaicans win, or Usain win the 100, the 200 and the 4x100. Three world records last time, one world record this time. And it is smiling again now. Well, Frater, Michael Frater, it's himself a world championship medalist, that's for sure. But what a team. Nesta Carter, Michael Frater, Yoann Blake, Usain Bolt. No Asafa Powell this time. But my goodness me, with that second and that third and fourth legs between between Yoann Blake and Usain Bolt.
Oh.
Canada have been disqualified.
Canada
it says,
disqualified.
In third place. So that moves Trinidad and Tobago up to third.
Ah, right, Canada.
So that's two medals tonight for Trinidad and Tobago. They had the javelin gold.
Let's look again at this relay. Now, we'll look at the changeovers again. When they come in, look at that. They have this sprint start situation. Hand goes out. Perfect. That's lovely. That is what it's about. That's what it's about. Getting the down sweep down. And here goes another one. Hand, he shouts, and he gets the hand. But the outgoing runner's got the speed, and therefore the baton speed remains good. Usain Bolt was safe. That one was safe, I have to say. But you don't need anything more than that. And he just ran away with it, didn't he? And the Canadians are very sad for them to get disqualified and to lose their bronze medal. Great shame. Always a shame when a team loses out. Oh, look. What a shame. They are distraught, and I can understand that. There may be a protest, but it depends what the offence was. But let's go back to a celebration here. An immense celebration.
The Jamaicans follow these boys round and round. And whilst the American women beat the Jamaican women, it certainly didn't happen tonight. Usain Bolt, one of the he's one of the greats, isn't he? He's one of the greats of all time. Let's not make any bones
in
about it.
In any sport, no yep. question about that. But let's pay tribute also to Nesta Carter and Michael Frater. They won't get the headlines, but they did play the part by running the first two legs, both in Beijing and in Daegu, and again here.
All sorts of happenings.
One can get too excited, perhaps.
Yeah,
being pulled in two directions. One direction by one of the officials and by the athlete in the other.
Well, you know, you have ups and you have downs. The Jamaicans are celebrating excellence. The Canadians are not celebrating. They are mourning the fact that they've lost a bronze medal. That is so, so difficult to take. Well, you've worked so hard in your preparation, and here are the new bronze medalists.
Yep, the same team, of course, as we saw, got a medal in 2008, and they've now got another one, unless, of course, there's another protest, but that's unlikely. If they've been disqualified, there will have been a reason, either the baton outside the lane or running inside the lane.
Let's just watch these pictures. Yeah, let's just watch these pictures, because they are marvellous. Johan Blake. What a quartet. Oh. What a showman.
Well, once again, three gold medals for him, just as he had in Beijing, and it's a unique feat. To do it once is sensational. To come back and do it all over again, and another world record.
Wow.
And the Americans as well. You know, they've taken 0.34 off their national record as well. And the Trinidad and Tobagonians can celebrate their bronze.
Not the way the Canadians wanted to finish this championship. I must say that those seams at the end were a little bit worrying, for as far as the Jamaicans were concerned and the world record was concerned and the response of this vast audience here in the Olympic Stadium was concerned.
Except that we'd seen them exchange all the way through and we didn't see any problems.
36.84. Wow. 9.2 for each 100 meters. Three of them, of course, have a flying start, so let's take that into account. But it averages out at 9.2. How close the fans are getting to the great man here. How close. And to Johan Blake, who's proved himself here as a great, great champion in terms of his performances here in the Olympic Stadium. These scenes are wonderful.
If you look at that time, if you say the first runner, say, ran 10 seconds, then the other three average 8.8. Now, you can take about a second for a flying start, but that means they've all run about 9.8 each on average.
Yep, yep.
Now, this is the is this where the Canadians make the problem?
Yeah, well, let's have a look and see what happens here. They're now coming in to the box. Now they're coming into the box. Where is his hand? Look. Oh,
cut away.
They're cut away, right. Sorry, we can't help you with that. We could certainly have analysed it. There may well be a protest. Their team management will want to see the footage.
Oh, yes.
They will want to see the footage.
So they should.
And absolutely right.
They'll be in there now, guys, looking at the video and slowing it down. They'll do it a frame a second. They'll know exactly whether they've been infringed the rules at all.
But the crowd are still enraptures at what they've seen today as the Jamaicans celebrate. And there are so many Jamaican supporters, of course, here in London, and they'll all have been thrilled, those who are here today on an epic occasion, just as they were, of course, when he won the 100 metres, just as they were when he won the 200 metres. Lots of Jamaican flags around, but not just Jamaican fans. Anyone who is here thrills to the sight of this great man and this great team. Well, we've had some truly wonderful moments here in the Olympic Stadium. It's more than met any of our expectations, and this final night has proved no exception.
We still have some medal celebrations to enjoy, of course, including
four,
this one.
Four of them in all, women's 4x4 as well as this one, and then the two field events decided tonight, the men's javelin and the women's high jump. We have all of those.
And then the 5,000.
And the 5,000, of course.
Let's have a look at lane 5 for Canada here now. Let's see what happens. Now, they've got to get the next yellow line. They must hand over before the next yellow line.
He's gone out quick.
Oh, I've done it again. I would love to be able to advise you on whether I agree or not, but I can't get far enough.
Well, the first of our victory ceremonies will be for the javelin, which, of course, John was following as a javelin thrower and coach himself with great enthusiasm. And this produced the biggest surprise of the championships.
Well, I think
except for John Thrower's own pick.
No, I didn't say he'd win earlier, but I did say that the sort of no pressure, good on the runway and the qualifying, the environment, the crowd and everything like that. And sometimes people can just race to the occasion. And, you know, he threw a personal best in the first round, and then he continued to flourish in the second round. And the lead was there for a long time, and nobody could pick it back. So
high jump was.
So nobody could pick it back. And we got Mr. Gerhard Heiberg, the IOC member from Norway, involved in the presentations along with Mr. Katsuyuki Tanaka, an IAAF council member, making the presentations to the javelin throwers. Well, Ruskinen takes the bronze medal in this javelin event. He started with 79.60, he made the cut at 81.60, and then in the fifth round, 84 meters 12 to move him into the bronze medal position, and then he held on to it for the rest of the competition. Just one round, he had lots of people having a go at him because he was seventh at the cut stage, where eight athletes go for a further three throws. So he was the second one up to throw in the fourth, fifth and sixth rounds. But in the fifth round, he made that bronze medal his own, 84 meters 12. Pietsia of the Ukraine threw 84.51 in response to the eventual gold winner's second round throw, which we'll come to in a second. 84.51, that was his best throw. He finished with 83.53, but his best throw got him the silver medal this evening. So a great performance from the Ukrainian. But the winner is the 19-year-old athlete from Trinidad and Tobago, the first ever gold medal won by that country. And his name is Kishon Wolcott, and he threw it in the second round. It stood there for a long time on its own. He threw 83.51, which was a new record in the first round, and in the second round he threw further, that 84.58, and he wins the gold medal just by 7 centimeters from the Ukrainian. But it's gold for Trinidad and Tobago. What a great performance by the young man. World junior champion in 2012, Olympic champion in 2012.
Well, never before has a Trinidad and Tobago athlete won any colour medal in the field events. And Kishawn Walcott joining Hazley Crawford as their Olympic champions.
So they'll be celebrating in the islands tonight, I think, I feel.
I bet you that they're minting a stamp in his name. He's taken over Mo Farah's celebration. He has. Usain Bolt anchors Jamaica home to a new world record. We'll confirm all of that in a moment.
And that's the baton that looked there. The official tried to take it off him and he didn't give it back. And then the officious official stormed around to try and get it back.
Well, it's a good job he stopped because you'd never have caught him. That's the beast. Wonderful. Great moments. And so they should surround the board and the photographers will click away.
And encourage such expressions.
Yes. Johan Blake, nicknamed the beast. Grr. There it is then. The new world record in the 4x100 meters relay of 36.84. The United States, another national record, 37.04. And Trinidad and Tobago, 38.12 in bronze medal position. Canada disqualified, obviously for an offence on that final change, but we can't verify that because we haven't actually seen the pictures. We almost did twice. Wonderful, wonderful final. Still more presentations to come. The men's 4x100 meters relay, the women's high jump.
Yep.
Still to come before we conclude this evening.
And the 5,000 meters.
Yeah. Now we also have a little wager here, fellas, because I wonder which one they're going to put on last. Are they going to go for Bolt or Mo, do you think? Who's going to be the final presentation tonight?
We will see.
All will be fulfilled. What we do know, it's got to be tonight.
Yeah.
And the crowd really have had a fantastic night of athletics. I mean, there haven't been a lot of races or field events, but the quality, you know, the quality of the competition, not necessarily distances, heights. Yeah. Or
well, some of the distances and heights have been pretty good with three world records, of course.
Yeah.
And some of the standard and depth has been terrific as well. Well, we've got five victory ceremonies to go. Here's the next. The women's 4x4 comes next. We'll tick them off gradually. Well, this wasn't a race which was, if you like, highly competitive in terms of the fact that it was close because all these three teams were clearly separated, but it was still some magnificent performances. Meliton Sanchez Arivas of Panama, a member of the IOC, to make the presentation, accompanied by Mrs. Anna Riccardi, council member of the IAAF. Jamaican sprinting is in very good hands, both male and female, and in this case the Jamaican women step up to receive their bronze medals. Christine Day, Rosemary White, Sherika Williams and Navleen Williams-Mills. Three of this team, exception being Christine White, were a member of the bronze medal team in Beijing 2008, and they're continuing all very distinguished careers. And the silver medal went to Russia, and again many of the same team, three of them, competed in Beijing and won the silver medals there, because this team is Gushina, Krivoshapka, Firova and Anchuk. First three were in the Beijing team, and of course Anchuk here also the winner of the 400 meter hurdles in splendid style in the great victory over Lashinda Demos a few days ago. And then we have the very clear winners. Yet another absolutely wonderful performance by a team from the United States of America. Dee Dee Trotter, Alison Felix, Francina McCordery, and Sanya Richards-Ross. Dee Dee Trotter adding gold to the bronze that she got in the individual 400 meters. Alison Felix, who now has 7 Olympic medals, 3 goals here, 1 gold before. Francina McCorry adding a gold medal. And Sanya Richards-Ross, double gold here from the 2 golds that she's already got. So that takes her up to 4 as well. 4 gold medals to equal the women's all-time record for both Felix and Richards-Ross. An all-time record for women in athletics events at the Olympic Games. Such names as Fanny Bankers-Kern and Evelyn Ashford. You now add Alison Felix and Sanya Richards-Ross. Two very enduring great athletes, both individual champions, both 4x400 champions, and Felix, of course, also 4x100 meter champion.
Still more to come. Still more to receive the accolade of this enthusiastic crowd, which has seen one of the great evenings of athletics this evening again. Just applauding now. I don't know whether you heard the announcement in the background, but just to say a big thank you, and the crowd responding to a thank you to all those behind the scenes who have made this Olympic Games so successful. And it has been a successful Games, there is no question about that. One of the great ones. For me, it's my 10th Olympic Games as a commentator, and I have to say that whilst many have been most enjoyable, this has been the best. For me, it's been the best, and it's absolutely sensational, the atmosphere in this stadium, for mornings, for evenings, for first sessions, second sessions, and really the stadiums, all of the areas outside of the Olympic Park have been filled with thousands and thousands of people who found it at times difficult to achieve the tickets that they've got tonight. And there was much criticism of the way in which the tickets were handled, but at the end of the day, thousands have come, thousands have enjoyed, and they will go away with the sort of memories that one should go away with after witnessing the greatest festival on earth, the Olympic Games. The next victory ceremony just about to be. High jump coming up next, John. One of the great competitions, that, wasn't it?
Well, it turned out to be a fascinating contest, didn't it? And count back again came in to decide the silver and bronze position, but the clear winner was Shikharova of Russia. She cleared first time the heights up to 203, and then on a second attempt went clear at 205. So she really was literally a head and shoulders above the other competitors. But we'll congratulate all three of them, lined up now to receive the accolades of the crowd, and Mr. Adam Pengilly, the IOC member of Great Britain. And once again coming out onto the trackside to be part of the presentation group, Sir Guy Bukka, the world's greatest male pole vault champion ever. The world record will stay there for a while, I think, 6 meters 14. And of course, he's the IAAF vice president. So the bronze medalist, Iskolina of Russia. She jumped 2 meters 03. That was a new personal best for Iskolina. And she takes away the bronze medal. She cleared the same height as the silver medalist, but on count back, she receives bronze. And all of the athletes that receive their medals do have a very close look at it, because I think it's got some intricacies on there which are well worth looking at. So Brigitta Barrett of the USA takes the silver medal. 2 meters 03, it's a PB. In fact, the top five in this competition equaled their season best or set personal best, and it was only the gold medalist who had a best of 207 set in the past that actually didn't achieve that personal best in this competition.
Mm-hmm.
So Chicharova of Russia takes the gold medal back to Russia. She cleared 2 meters and 5 centimeters on her second attempt, and that was enough to seal the win tonight in the Olympic Stadium. So Russia take gold and bronze in tonight's high jump final. A fantastic result and a fantastic high jump competition of the highest quality, and she really does really appreciate that medal, and emotions will be flowing when the national anthem is played. And there the result is confirmed, absolutely. Russian take gold and bronze, and Barrett from the USA takes the silver in the women's high jump.
Usain Bolt, he had the baton taken away from him, and he says, "You can have it back. Please, please." He's got his baton back.
It's a world record baton. You know, there aren't many about.
That's
so
right, absolutely.
You can see that appearing on eBay if it slipped and went out of his bag at some point in the very near future.
I wonder if he's got the one from Daegu as well.
Wow.
There's a lot of very happy people here. They've been privileged to be here, as we all have, both tonight and throughout these games, which have been such a huge success.
Has most definitely been a games which has brought the world out of its doom, in a sense, financial doom that's been affecting us over the last year or so, 2 years. These happy moments must be cherished. Doom and gloom forgotten. Waiting for the ceremonies to come. We still have the men's 5,000 meters to come. We still have the men's 4x1, and they're all now getting the Mo Farah celebration right. Look at this, wonderful. Thank you. I wonder which of the medal ceremonies will come out last of all. Will it be a British gold medal in front of a British crowd? Will it be a Jamaican gold medal in front of a British crowd?
One of the possibilities, of course, is the fact that it could be the sprint relay, because it's possible that the Canadians may have launched a little bit of an investigation into their disqualification. They probably have had plenty of time to go through the evidence, but nonetheless, that might just have delayed things a little bit.
Yes, good point.
One certainly hopes that youngsters like the ones we're seeing there will have been inspired by what they've seen here and will take up the sport, whatever sport they may choose, with zeal in the forthcoming years. This is one of the important things of the Olympic Games. It's supposed to have an ongoing legacy in so many ways, and the participation of youngsters in sport is vital. But throughout, Stuart, I think one of the great things has been just the sheer joy and the sheer exhilaration of people just to be in the Olympic Park, just to go to whatever their venues, and just to put aside other cares and so on, and just join in the pleasure of being part of this wonderful event.
It is without doubt the greatest show on earth, isn't it? All the nations of the world come together every 4 years to compete together in competition all nations. Here we go. I think I can see the cameras looking across towards the into the tunnel. Now they moved away again, I think. Just advising the crowd why we have a delay and all of the processes that athletes have to go through once they leave the track. I think he's already gone. Go Mo, that's a bit late. Here we come, the men's 4x100 meter relay victory ceremony then, next to be received by this crowd. Once again, a final opportunity for the crowds and the television audiences to greet a Jamaican super team, and within it a superman in terms of Usain Bolt. Pat McQuaid, IOC member for Ireland. Hence, Jörg Wirtz, the IAAF council member. He will present the flowers. Well, Trinidad and Tobago elevated to bronze medal position. Canada disqualified with the last change, a judge not to be within the takeover of zone. So Kesten Bledman and Mark Burns, Emmanuel Callender, and of course Richard Thompson, himself a medalist in Olympic finals. Well, the silver goes to the United States, who on this day have been absolutely superb. New national record, 37.04. But, and that of course equaled the previous world record. There's Tyson Gay and Ryan Bailey, the big man. The previous two, of course, Trell Kimmins and Justin Gatlin. They're on standing in the order in which they ran. The Americans have won this title 15 times in the past. Jamaica had only won it once, and that was in 2008. How things change. A quartet of individuals who came together and shattered their own world record. Nesta Carter and Michael Freiter. Johan Blake, what an impact he's made. Marvellous, marvellous theatre he brings to this major championship, this festival of sport. These pictures will be transmitted and are being transmitted all over the world. Whether you be in the morning, in the afternoon, the evening, in the middle of the night, you're witnessing greatness. And a gold medal and an Olympic championship going to a Jamaican quartet that ran a new world record. 36.84. There is but one victory ceremony that remains. The name of the recipient of the next gold medal being chanted around this Olympic Stadium. Below us, Usain Bolt gives that familiar pose before they finally disappear just off your shot. They wait for a Briton who has established another moment of Olympic history as the great man continues to conduct the crowd. And he departs, the great man, and how entertaining has he been over the period of these Olympic athletics program, this Olympic athletics program. Usain Bolt. And now the world's media wait to greet a historic man. How fitting it is that at home Briton should greet its very special Olympic champion. They will need no encouragement to celebrate this award, the men's 5,000 metres, the final award. Margwitkeme Bahane, the IOC member for Ethiopia. And the flowers presented by Dalan Al-Hamad, IAAF Vice President. Thomas Longosiwa of Kenya is the bronze medalist. Dejan Gebremeskel of Ethiopia is the silver medalist. Incredible reception for a young man who has achieved greatness, and I mean that within the context of Olympics, the Olympic movement. Only five other men have won the 5 and 10,000 meter double in the history of the Olympic Games. Mo Farah of Great Britain is the sixth. And what a reception. Unbelievable reception. Mo Farah, his family celebrate the greatest moment in his short life, a moment that will go down not only in his history book, but the history book of the Olympic movement. It has been an incredible evening. The world champion, Maria Savinova of Russia, won a fast 800 metres in 1:56.19. The high jump was won by Anna Chicharova in 2 metres and 5. The men's javelin gold went to a 19-year-old from Trinidad and Tobago, Kashawn Wolcott. The United States women won the 4x400-metre relay in great style. And then the Jamaican men smashed the world record in the 4x100-metres relay. And, of course, Mo Farah of Great Britain joined the greats. The sixth winner of the 5 and 10,000 meter double in Olympic history. We'll leave you now with these pictures of celebration. And just to say from Peter Matthews, John Troer and me, Stuart Story, we've enjoyed bringing this athletics program to you from the Olympic Stadium. Tomorrow there is another day, it's the men's marathon, but from here in the Olympic Stadium, goodbye.